Are we ready to go? Yes, it's 6:30. So very, very good morning to everybody. As usual, President Sushma Bhatnagar just called me a few minutes ago to say that she has to rush to the hospital. As usual, lots of issues. So she has once again given me the privilege. And I am delighted to introduce Gauraya Chinchalkar. She's an MD from in palliative medicine from Tata Memorial. She worked at the Homi Bhabha Cancer Hospital at Varanasi. She received a recipient of the IDRPC Award 2020 by the American Society of Clinical Oncology, or ASCO. And she is the winner of the Bruce Davis Gold Medal, which is an annual feature in the memory of Bruce Davis from the Institute of Palliative Medicine, Calicut. Gauraya is going to talk about a very important subject, and that is about sleep, something that we do not pay too much of attention to, and I think it's an excellent idea to have a talk on this. So all yours, Gauraya, please, you may start your presentation.
Thank you, sir. So we'll start with a simple definition of sleep. So we all know what is sleep, but just to define it is a reversible behavioral state of perceptual disengagement from and unresponsiveness to the environment. So let's understand this in detail. The normal human adult enters sleep through NREM sleep, with NREM and REM sleep alternating throughout the night. So NREM is non-rapid eye movement, and REM is rapid eye movement sleep. And stage one NREM sleep is associated with low arousal threshold, that is, the person can be awakened easily. The stage two NREM sleep is signaled by sleep spindles and K complexes on EEG, and it requires a more intense stimulus for arousal. For the slow wave sleep, which is the joint name for stage three and stage four NREM sleep, we need incrementally larger stimulus to produce arousal than stage one or stage two. The slow wave sleep is associated with parasomnias like sleepwalking. And with respect to REM, the mental activity of human REM sleep is associated with dreaming. And there is atonia due to direct inhibition of alpha motor neurons and also rapid eye movements. Muscle twitches and cardiorespiratory irregularities are also there. And the arousal threshold here is variable. We do have a lot of changes in sleep with age, and this pattern is like for the first year of life, the transition from wake to sleep state is mostly accomplished through REM sleep as compared to NREM sleep in adults. The cycle duration is shorter, so about maybe 60 minutes, 50 to 60 minutes, as compared to that in adults, that is approximately 90 minutes. And like the newborns, we know they sleep 16 to 18 hours a day without a clear circadian rhythm. But as they gradually develop a day and night cycle and enter sleep through NREM, which happens over the first 2 to 6 months, so there is a slow decrease in total sleep time. And fully developed EEG patterns of NREM sleep stages, they emerge over the 2 to 6 months. And slow wave sleep is maximum in young children, decreasing by 50% in the second decade, and by approximately 60 years, it's quite diminished, particularly in men. So REM sleep as a percentage of total sleep is maintained well into old age, and also arousals during sleep increase markedly with age. So we get a lot of old people complaining that they have frequent night awakenings, but then this would be physiological. And the physiology of sleep has multiple The sleep and wake states are regulated by multiple neuronal systems located in the brainstem, diencephalon, and telencephalon. So the dorsal pathway innervates the thalamus, which facilitates transmission of sensory information to the cortex. And the ventral pathway innervates the hypothalamus, basal forebrain, and other forebrain structures, which together excite the cortex. Hence, wakefulness is actually achieved when both ventral and dorsal pathways are activated. So, A here is the sagittal view of brain, providing overview of the wake control network. And B is the sagittal view of the brainstem and diencephalon, showing orexin neurons and their projections, which also again contribute in wakefulness. And to explain it in details how this wake and sleep cycle works, in short, the wake drive, which defers sleep if required, is mainly regulated by amygdala, which detects threat, and there is nucleus accumbens for goal acquisition. Then there is the sleep drive, which arises from three main sources that accumulate throughout the day. That is, there is energy depletion, where adenosine is involved, immune activation, where cytokines are involved. There is neuroplasticity. So the central circadian clock under the control of suprachiasmatic nucleus biases the weight given to the wake versus sleep drives. And these signals are integrated in the thalamus and they cause either sleep states or wake state. So here we have the flip-flop switch model of sleep-wake regulation. And this circuit consists of two sets of mutually inhibitory components. The sleep slide is the ventrolateral preoptic nucleus. And the arousal side includes tuberomammillary nucleus, the histaminic neurons, and the brainstem arousal regions. So each side of the switch inhibits the other. And the hypocretin or orexin neurons in the hypothalamus, they project to the wakefulness arousal systems and interact with the sleep active and sleep promoting systems. So basically they act as stabilizers between wakefulness maintaining and sleep promoting systems. So this prevents a sudden and inappropriate transition between the two systems. So we know this system is disrupted in narcolepsy and cataplexy. So there are many factors causing variation in sleep onset apart from age, like we just discussed. So these factors are behavioral and internal needs. So most behaviors such as foraging, courting, and predator defense are incompatible with sleep. And there are motivational processes which modulate the propensity of humans to stay awake or go to sleep. So when motivated, humans can stay awake and engage in various activities such as maybe reading a book or attending a party. And this is far beyond their physiological bedtime and ignoring the homeostatic and circadian sleep drives. Then we have the previous sleep history. So a person who has experienced sleep loss on one or more nights, he shows a sleep pattern that favors slow wave sleep during recovery, which is combinedly NREM3 and NREM4. So this recovery sleep is prolonged and has a higher arousal threshold than basal sleep. And also with sleep loss, slow wave sleep tends to be preferentially recovered compared with REM sleep, which tends to recuperate only after recuperation of the slow wave sleep. Then we have the circadian rhythm. So there is this model, the process C and S model. And according to this, the sleep pressure, that is processes S, increases during wakefulness and declines during sleep in a cycle which is superimposed over the circadian cycle of activity. So this circadian cycle of activity is the process C. And wake-dependent homeostatic substances, they accumulate with wakefulness when they are sensed by a homeostatic system, they promote sleep. So these substances, as per this theory, are cytokines, mainly cytokines, adenosine and nitric oxide. And this pattern of sleep-wake organization follows the light-dark cycle and is coordinated by suprachiasmatic nucleus. Again, this pattern also persists in the absence of environmental time cues. So this demonstrates that there is existence of an intrinsic regulatory mechanism also. And it is not entirely dependent on the perception of day or night or other environmental cues. So the next variation of the next factor causing variation of sleep is environmental cues. So here again, the suprachiasmatic nucleus activates and which is activated and light inhibited. The suprachiasmatic nucleus activated and light inhibited production of melatonin conveys the message of darkness and induces night state physiological functions such as sleep-wake changes in blood pressure and metabolism. And the circadian clock can be synchronized to the environment by different cues like light, temperature, stress, exercise, food availability, and social interactions. So these enable us to anticipate rather than react to daily recurring events. And so we align our behaviors and physiology to the changing environment. This slide is the summary of the variations of sleep, the different factors that we just discussed. And the glutamate here is the principal excitatory neurotransmitter in the brain. And glutamate levels in cortex rise progressively during wakefulness and decline during NREM sleep. And most sleep promoting populations are GABAergic. So this was about the physiology of sleep, and coming to the classification of sleep disorders. So as per the International Classification of Sleep Diseases Disorders, which is a version 3, there are 6 major categories. And the insomnia category includes conditions that are characterized by difficulty initiating or maintaining sleep or by poor sleep quality. And we'll be dealing with this more in our presentation. Then there are sleep-related breathing disorders, which are characterized by abnormal respiration during sleep. And they include central sleep apnea, obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. Then there is sleep-related hyperventilation disorder and sleep-related hypoxemia disorder. And there are the central disorders of hypersomnolence, which have disorders primarily where the complaint is a daytime sleepiness that is not due to disturbed sleep or misaligned circadian rhythm. The circadian rhythm disorders have chronic or recurrent sleep disturbances due to misalignment between environment and the individual's sleep-wake cycle. There are parasomnias, which are undesirable physical events, that is either movement or behavior, or there are experiences, for example, emotions, perceptions, or dreams that occur during entry into sleep, within sleep, or during arousal from sleep. So these behaviors can be complex and appear purposeful. However, the patient has no conscious awareness of the behavior. And there are sleep-related movement disorders, which are characterized by simple stereotypic movements that disturb sleep. And patient may or may not be aware of the movements. And these are the few common terms that we'll be using. So there is sleep latency, which is the time to fall asleep following getting into bed. Then if the sleep latency of, there is a sleep latency of 30 minutes or more, this means it is called as problem falling asleep. Frequent awakenings mean problem staying asleep. and the sum of wake times from sleep onset to final awakening in the morning is WASO, that is wake after sleep onset. Then there is time in bed, which is the time from getting into bed to getting out of bed. And the total sleep time is the time in bed minus sleep latency and minus wake after sleep onset. Then sleep efficiency is the total sleep time divided by time in bed. So we encounter mainly three types of sleep disturbances in advanced cancer patients. Here the term insomnia has been defined as a persistent difficulty with sleep initiation, duration, consolidation, or quality that occurs despite adequate opportunity and circumstance for sleep and results in some form of daytime impairment. Talking about insomnia, researchers have reported 62 to 70% of patients with advanced cancer. They had poor sleep quality as assessed by the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index. And it should be noted that quality of sleep is not always related to the duration of sleep. So these are the diagnostic criteria for short-term insomnia. And they also go with three things, that is, the reported sleep-wake complaints cannot be explained purely by inadequate opportunity or circumstances. Then secondly, the sleep disturbances and associated daytime symptoms have been present for less than 3 months, and that the sleep-wake difficulty is not explained by another sleep disorder. And for chronic insomnia disorders, the mentioned criteria for short-term insomnia should occur at least 3 times per week and should have been present for at least 3 months. So from the various studies which have been done on advanced cancer patients, a varying prevalence of 15.3 to 75% for sleep disturbances, that is short and long-term insomnia, has been reported by subjective and objective tools of assessment, as we can see here. So coming to the factors which are associated with insomnia in advanced cancer patients, from the evidence, we see that insomnia may be associated with mainly anxiety, fatigue, depression, poor appetite, and uncontrolled symptoms like pain, shortness of breath, nausea, etc. These are the main symptoms which have been highlighted in this study. And in advanced cancer patients, sleep disturbances may be associated with or result in daytime sleepiness, cognitive impairment, anxiety, depression, decreased response to chemotherapy, and decreased overall survival, as has been mentioned in these studies. The other sleep disturbances which are commonly seen in advanced cancer patients, other than chronic and short-term insomnia, are vivid dreams with a prevalence of 34.5%. And nightmares with a prevalence of 18%. So the references for both are there in notes, which you'll get when this presentation is passed on to you. And both of the vivid dreams is actually not defined in International Classification of Sleep Disorders, version 3, but the description given in the study by Davis et al. In 2017 is unusually clear. Long dreams with elaborate scenario and possibly strong emotions that occur only when sleeping, and they are acutely remembered by the patients. So both of them, that is the vivid dreams and nightmares, they are associated with higher physiological burden, which in itself is associated with sleep disturbances. And also to mention that in a study by McLeod et al. In 2007, the nightmares are not associated with the use of opioid analgesics. So this is one study which refers or tries to see the factors of or association between opioids and nightmares. We have a few studies which have been done for sleep disturbances in terminal illnesses other than advanced cancer. Also, although they are very less in number as compared to the advanced cancer patients. So this study by Mohan et al. In 2013 compares the prevalence in multiple terminal illnesses like COPD, congestive heart failure, end-stage renal disease, dementia, HIV, Parkinsonism, and motor neuron disease. So the studies which are referred to in this study, they were done only, they refer only to sleep disturbances or poor quality sleep rather than elaborating the specific sleep disturbances like insomnia or vivid dreams. So they just mentioned that the patients have sleep disturbances or poor quality sleep in these terminal diseases. We don't have a lot of evidence based for diseases other than advanced cancer, elaborating the type of sleep disturbance. So coming to the evaluation of a patient with sleep disturbance. So we'll be stressing on these three particular aspects while evaluating a patient with sleep disturbances. So coming to the importance of sleep history, a detailed sleep history of the patient, which includes his or her sleep schedule, the bedtime behavior, the environment of his bedroom, and the details of nocturnal awakenings, the patient's behavior and thoughts during these nocturnal awakenings. They are important in forming the diagnosis as well as for the treatment. So the details which we should ask our patient are, you can see in the slide. Also important is the history of medications which the patient is taking, as it may also affect his or her sleep, particularly there are few antidepressants or cardiovascular drugs and other drugs that we frequently encounter in our practice. And the slide shows the possible medications, and this is all as per the American Academy of Sleep Medicine guidelines. Similarly, there are medical disorders like commonly GERD or congestive heart failure, etc. So these may be affecting patient's sleep, and hence they should be ruled out before we start treatment for targeting only insomnia. And this is also adapted from the clinical practice guidelines of American Academy of Sleep Medicine. In fact, all the evaluation and treatment has been adapted from their guidelines. So like we have questionnaires to assess fatigue and quality of life, depression. So there are certain questionnaires like we have the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index and the Insomnia Severity Index, which subjectively assess sleep. And most of them are in the form of self-reported questionnaires, and they mainly take into account sleep history and symptoms of the patient. So here are the examples of insomnia questionnaires used for baseline and treatment outcome assessment in patients. And Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index is very commonly used. So there are other tools like polysomnography or actigraphy. They are not routinely indicated, but they may be appropriate in individuals presenting with peculiar symptoms or signs of sleep disorders. That is so objective assessment tools, as we can see. So this is a detailed algorithm for evaluation of insomnia, and this has been adapted from American Academy of Sleep Medicine Clinical Practice Guidelines for various forms of sleep disturbances for those who are interested. But the mentioned insomnia disorder and the primary insomnia disorders, maybe we won't have much use of this algorithm of evaluation of insomnia in our practice, because mostly we don't see these disorders, but still it's good to have a look through it, so that in case there is something, we can either refer to a specialist or we will be able to diagnose and treat the disorder. So the latest guidelines for treatment, so they are divided into two parts, the non-pharmacological and the pharmacological one. And we see the non-pharmacological part first. So the most important thing to know while or when we start treating a palliative care patient with sleep disturbance is that we are trying to reduce the insomnia related symptoms and improve the sleep quality. So we may not achieve 100% relief. Also, the entire treatment is aimed to improve the quality of life of the patient, and hence promoting his or her feeling of well-being. And we do not want unnecessary burden on the patient in the name of treatment. So that should be our primary treatment goal. And keeping up with this spirit, we will first aim for non-pharmacological interventions so that pill burden can be avoided. Many of the patients are already on a lot of medications for multiple reasons. And this should not, the treatment of insomnia should not add on to that. So backed by multiple good quality studies, we have strong evidence for cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. And there was insufficient evidence to make recommendations for specific delivery methods, such as individual or group or internet, self-help or video, etc., for any of the given treatments. And we have conditional recommendations for use with not so good evidence. So hence the cognitive behavioral therapy has been listed for strong recommendation as per the American Academy of Sleep Medicine guidelines. There is, we can see brief therapies for insomnia, which includes different behavioral components, and there is stimulus control therapy, the sleep restriction therapy, and there is relaxation therapy. So also there were fewer than three proper studies for the use of cognitive therapy, the paradoxical intention, the mindfulness, the biofeedback, and the intensive sleep retraining. Hence, either there is conditional recommendation or no recommendations made for them, but they do work. And the details of each is provided in the slide, the first one and the earlier one here. So if we decide to go with the evidence, so there's only cognitive behavioral therapy, but otherwise we can try these things. Coming to the pharmacological interventions for sleep disturbances, there are many options that have been recommended again by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine. So they are benzodiazepine receptors, agonist modulators, benzodiazepines, and melatonin receptor agonists. So the doses, the specific sleep disturbance for the recommended drugs in the three categories, that is benzodiazepines, benzodiazepine receptor agonist modulators, and melatonin receptor agonists, they've been mentioned. And also the dose modification for elderly, for hepatic renal failure, have also been mentioned here. But the GABA mimetics to explain the mechanism, how they affect the sleep-wake cycle. The GABA mimetics, they act on the amygdala and the ascending arousal system to induce sleep. The melatonin receptor agonists, they act on suprachiasmatic nucleus, regulating the circadian clock. And there are other drugs like orexin antagonists, which act on the orexin neurons in the wake-promoting region of the brain. And there are other drugs like H1 antagonists, sedating antidepressants, or antipsychotics, which act on the ascending arousal system to reduce arousal during wakefulness. So that is the mechanism for most of the drugs which are like commonly encountered. So even with this recommendation, we still need to be careful before prescribing medications, as our patients may have multiple comorbidities, poor organ function, and they're prone to drug interaction. So without like going blindly with this recommendation, I would still suggest to titrate it on a per patient basis, looking at if the patient actually needs the drugs and which should be given. And this treatment for this algorithm for treatment of insomnia, even this stresses on the evaluation and detailed history, followed by doing the behavioral approaches first, and then medications to be prescribed last. So maybe we should, rather than prescribing or jumping onto drugs for this, we should try for other behavioral therapies which have been recommended. And also a simpler one, non-pharmacological approach, which is more worth mentioning, is sleep hygiene, where we try to implement things like a quiet and comfortable sleeping environment, then avoiding caffeine-containing foods and emotionally charged conversations just before bedtime, and getting exercise and exposure to sunlight during the day. Avoiding lying in the bed when we are not sleeping. So little things like these, common things, and this is sleep hygiene. This may be effective to prevent the sleep disturbances, or treat sleep disturbances, reduce them for our palliative care patients. So I know it's just like half an hour, but this is coming to the end of the presentation, and I hope people have made it to the end without falling asleep. And if there are any questions, we can take them.
Thank you, GC. Nice presentation. We have one question. Do you want to take it now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, please go ahead.
So there is a question from Dr. Raji Suresh. In the medication history, steroid administration must be explored. That's what she says.
Yeah, definitely. Because these recommendations were from American Academy of Sleep Medicine. So they do not necessarily take into account all the palliative care patients, but steroid is important. Especially we get a lot of patients who have been prescribed steroids like 3 times a day, morning, evening, and night. So those patients who are taking it like at 9 p.m., 8 p.m., like well into the night, they also have this restlessness and they have sleep disturbances. So steroid is one thing. If you are starting a patient on a steroid, try to finish his doses like by maybe 5, 6, something like that, to avoid the sleep disturbances because of steroids. That is true.
Thank you. There are a few more questions. Is there any logic in drinking milk before going to sleep? What are your thoughts on that?
I don't know about it.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's any evidence.
Exactly.
For this, or, but yeah, like, we all feel better probably when we drink milk and go to sleep. So that can be tried.
Also, okay. Also, collective. There's a question about quetiapine. How often is it used? I think you can answer that, and also others who are practicing palliative care can chip in if you are using quetiapine in your practice regularly.
Can we have input from Dr. Nagesh first?
A bit louder, Gaurai. I can't.
Sorry.
Hear you.
Can we have input from Dr. Nagesh, sir,
Dr.
for this
Nagesh.
Question?
I think you should talk to Shobha and a few other people.
Shobha, madam, if you are there, please chip in. If you are using quetiapine in your practice and others as well.
I think there are so many senior people. So quetiapine is actually used very commonly. And like it again depends on the liver function, the renal function and the status of the patient. So yes, quetiapine can be given.
Okay, Dr. Raji has put down the same thing. Milk contains tryptophan inducing melatonin synthesis. That is why talks about milk. And participants can unmute themselves. I have started the function. Shobha madam, you can unmute yourself. Just try unmuting yourself. I think you will be able to unmute yourself.
So I was not aware of this. So yes, if there's evidence or something which points towards that it will help, the milk may help. It's a good thing.
Okay. Seva Mission. Insomnia symptoms are overwhelming and quite distressing. Do you think patients will be receptive to non-pharmacological methods?
Yeah, they are actually receptive because most of the times the things that are mentioned in the sleep hygiene intervention, when we take the sleep history, we realize that even they are lacking the basic things which should be done, and just by like slightly tweaking their schedules or very small changes that we can make in their daily morning to evening thing, that actually helps, and we have seen this in our practice.
Yeah, so our madam is finally, I think she's unmuted, please.
Hello. Hi, good morning. Thanks, Arun. And you see this practice very commonly, especially among our oncologists, that for sleep they prescribe quetiapine. And I think that's a very wrong trend, and people have got down to the habit where we are practicing at the moment that quetiapine is for sleep. You know, they have kind of stopped Alprax and Alprazolam and those kind of medications, and they are on to quetiapine at the moment. Is the trend that we see right now. Which is not the a scientific way of approaching it is what I feel. I think Raji can corroborate. We work together at Amruta. So this is something which we have seen. And I think Seema and Chitra and all everybody would say that that's not the right way to go. And evidence also shows that is what I feel. Of course, so there are indications when you need to give quetiapine, but just for insomnia, you don't do that. So that's my point. What does everyone think, and what is their way of practicing, or people around them, how do they practice, is just what I wanted to know.
Shobha, Rajasri here. I too agree with what you have said right now, because I do have seen people prescribing quetiapine, not only in the oncology setting, even otherwise also. As you said, it is not a practice we should encourage, because all of us know that quetiapine is mechanism of action, and the indications are different. So even I'm a bit concerned about prescribing hypnotics or nitrates as soon as the patient patients say that I'm finding it difficult to sleep or I can't sleep. It is our tendency to prescribe any night sedative like lorazepam or clonazepam as soon as we get a comment from the patient. I have put in the comment or chat box that are we justified in prescribing hypnotics without exploring much for common sleep disorders. I invite comment from experts. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think, Gauraj, you can stop sharing because we are now mostly talking about our practice settings. Yeah, great. So there was an important comment in the chat box about gadgets. And I think that is very important. Avoid gadgets for a proper sleep hygiene. And I think everybody will agree to that. It is very important. Like taking your phone with you and browsing on the internet, these things are something that will hamper the sleep. So this is important to follow, I guess.
Yeah, there is actually, this is also part of the sleep hygiene that these rays which are coming from the gadgets and the mental activity which is associated, they actually make us, they arouse us. So that also hampers the sleep. So the sleep wake drives here, I'm talking about that. And these gadgets should be avoided before bedtime, as I was talking about caffeine and other things.
Arun, I would like to make another comment.
Yeah, sure, please.
So it's about the inflammatory agents, the cytokines, leukotrienes, etc., which circulates, especially in cancer and HIV patients. So HIV patients, there are a lot of studies which says they have insomnia. And once ART starts to set in, and once they come over their cachectic anorexic stage, their sleep starts to become better. So anti-inflammatory agents can help with sleep as a kind of a theory. And I don't know whether you've noticed, if anybody has noticed, that when you take paracetamol at night, if you're slightly feverish or if you have some aches and pains, etc., if you take paracetamol at night, a lot of people say that their sleep becomes better. What is your take on that, anyone?
Everybody's gone to sleep, I think.
No, sir. Shobha, could it be due to better symptom control? I agree with the cytokine release and the associated metabolism. But, you know, like if a person sleeps better after taking NSAID or paracetamol, I wonder, it may be attributed to symptom relief as well. What is your comment and the comments from experts? I'm not sure about that.
No. So obviously it is an anti-inflammatory, anti-cytokine kind of reaction that you get from Brufen, for example, if you take. There was a study which they conducted to see anti-cancerous effect with Brufen on a long-term basis. And they felt that, you know, that's getting better because symptom-wise people were getting better. So that also definitely improves sleep. But then paracetamol, I don't know whether that helps in condition like HIV or cancer. But paracetamol generally, when you're unwell, that helps. So, but paracetamol is not, we are not taking it in a very high dose to induce its anti-inflammatory action. We are kind of taking it to induce its antipyretic action. Maybe the symptoms and the signs that people have, or the cytokine release people have with mild diseases, mild common cold, flu, and etc., are not that high that a single dose of paracetamol is enough. Because it.
Shubha?
Yeah, I think her connection is fluctuating.
Okay, I got it. And my comment is that, I mean, I noted one comment in the chat box that benzodiazepines work well, and also like NSAIDs provide a good night sleep. there are two questions. I mean, benzodiazepines work well, that all of us know. But if the patient has got some psychological concerns, are we justified in prescribing benzodiazepine for inducing or promoting sleep without exploring it much? So probably a good communication or sort of ventilation, allowing ventilation from the patient's side can improve her sleep. So without going into that, if we are, you know, just we are going to jump into medicine prescription, that will mechanically, you know, what that will, you know, promote more, I mean, polypharmacy, and we will just keep on prescribing it, and it may be continued for long without exploring much. That is one comment. And how about prescribing NSAIDs and paracetamol for inducing sleep? Though maybe a single dose. I mean, are we justified in doing that? That is rationally, I mean, we have to look at the rationality in the prescription as well. Comments.
So I completely agree that we should not be jumping onto prescribing medications first. In fact, non-pharmacological methods or talking to the patient, it works really well, and asking them to change few habits also works well. That is my opinion regarding this.
Okay, thank you. Definitely, it is important. There are no more chats on any different subject. And if there are no more comments, I would request Dr. Nagesh sir to please conclude.
Anybody else has any comments?
We are in good time today.
Thank you,
Gauraya, for that.
Good. So thank you very much, Gauraya, for a very good presentation. Of course, the initial part of it, I kind of dozed off because I've forgotten my physiology. I studied that more than 51 years ago. No, but I think it's important. And the practical aspects that you have brought out are important. And there is no one size fits all sort of approach. We have to help our patients, counsel them, sleep hygiene, and of course, when required, medication. So thank you very much once again. And thank you, everybody.